Today on Larry King Now, athletes who've defied the odds. We'll meet snowboarder Kevin Pearce.
I was on this set path, and I was a snowboarder, and I was competing, and I was successful, and that was my life. And I was in Park City, fell, had this accident, and now I have to figure out what's next. I love the freedom. There are no rules, there are no limits, there's nothing on your snowboard. It's all about you doing what you want.
Plus, the extraordinary story of a one-armed basketball player, Kevin Laue.
People come out underestimating me from the get-go, which I use to my advantage. You know, I come out and play hard from the beginning, and, you know, I surprise them.
It's all next on Larry King Now. Welcome to Larry King Now. On New Year's Eve 2009, 49 days before the 2010 Winter Olympics, American professional snowboarder and gold medal favorite Kevin Pearce suffered a severe brain injury while training in Park City, Utah. Sadly, Kevin's career was cut short and his life changed forever. His story of tragedy and triumph is the subject of a new HBO documentary titled The Crash Reel. Kevin joins us now. We'll talk about the documentary in the second segment. What happened?
Wow. December 31st, 2009, my life changed. It took a huge, huge turn.
And why were you out snowboarding on New Year's Eve?
It's a good question. Why wasn't I partying?
Yeah, why?
Yeah, I wanted to go to the Olympics, and that was my goal, and I needed to train, and I needed to practice, and I was working on getting better, and I was up there in the half pipe and trying one of the new tricks, and it just didn't work out for me, and it was crazy.
What was the trick?
It was called a cab double cork, and what that is on a snowboard is you're going up the half pipe wall backwards, and you take off, and you do two flips and two spins, and you're supposed to come down the wall going forward, and I came down the wall sideways and caught my front edge and slammed to my head, and I don't remember that day.
Had you done it before?
I had done it, yeah. I hadn't done it that well. You know, I was still learning this trick. It was very new to me. And
were you going to do it in the Olympics?
I needed to do it in the Olympics to have done well. I needed that trick to kind of help me get to the top. And that was where I wanted to be, was at the... I wanted to win the Olympics, and I needed this trick to win.
Where did you grow up?
I grew up in Vermont, and I grew up snowboarding, and you'll see
so
in the
you
film.
Took it up as a kid.
Yeah, I have three
you
older
see that
brothers.
Movie, right?
Yeah, I have three older brothers, and they kind of were there from the start.
Were you a skier, too?
I was never a skier. I was right into snowboarding, and that was it. My older brothers were snowboarding, and I wanted to copy them, and that's what they were doing. So I was like, I want to get on a board.
All right, so what happened after the accident? Were you knocked out? Obviously, you weren't conscious.
Yeah, so I was put in an induced coma for a week and a half, and then I was in the critical care in Salt Lake City for 27 days. And I don't remember, it's crazy, because I don't remember any of those 27 days. I have no memory of being in that
remember
hospital.
The crash?
Nope, I don't remember any of that day.
So when you relate this crash, you're telling it to me as it was told to you?
Yep, it's all information that I've been given, and it's crazy not
what
to remember.
What do you remember?
I remember the night before. It was my best friend's 21st birthday, and I didn't go out and drink, and I mean, we went out and partied a little bit, but I was sober and kind of, my head was in this place where I needed to learn this trick and I needed to focus on.
So you're in a coma?
Yep.
How long?
A week and a half. And
then what?
And then I stayed in critical care for three more weeks, and then I was taken in an airplane from Utah to Denver, where I spent the following 3.5 months in a rehab hospital, relearning. I mean, I had to relearn how to walk and talk, and I had to learn how to swallow again, and I had to learn everything from the start.
What was it like when you woke up?
I don't remember waking up. You know, I don't have any memory of that time and
what
that
do you
whole
remember?
Piece of my life. I remember being taken in the airplane from the University of Utah to Craig Hospital in Denver, and that's the first memory I have.
Why did you do it? Why do you risk death?
Because that's what I loved, and that's what I had the most fun doing. And
the extreme skier Sarah Burke passed away on that slope, right?
On that same half pipe.
Is Park City a tough place to snowboard?
You know, it's kind of a it's so weird how that happened to me and then that happened to Sarah. It's such a fluke because that's like one of the best half pipes in the world. And that's like, that mountain is so amazing. And so it's just crazy how they both happened in that pipe.
When did you get on a snowboard again?
2 years. I waited 2 full years until I got back on the board and then I started riding again. But no more half pipes and no jumps and none of that stuff. Just kind of powder and careful and smart and
no competitive.
No competitive.
What do you like about it?
I love the freedom and the feeling, the sense of just being able to go out and do whatever you want. I mean, there's nobody telling you anything. There are no rules. There are no limits. There's nothing on your snowboard. It's all about you doing what you want.
When did you decide you wanted to compete, that you wanted to be an Olympian?
I decided that I wanted to be an Olympian when I started doing well in these events, and it was a very slow progress, and it was a very slow process.
All in Vermont, right?
In Vermont, and then I moved out to Mammoth, California, and then it was around the world, you know, New Zealand, Japan, Norway. I went to Greenland. I went to everywhere I got to travel. Anywhere there was snow, I went.
They're beautiful glasses. What happened to your eyes?
So I ended up fracture. I had an orbital fracture on my right eye. When I landed, I struck my head, and you know where I hit affected my eyes, and so I had really serious eye issues. And then I got eye surgery, and now my eyes aren't as bad, but they're still having some pretty bad problems.
Can you drive?
I can drive. Yep.
You see all right?
When I'm just sitting, I'm good. But like, when I'm trying to be, when my body's in motion, my brain can't figure out how to align my eyes, so everything goes double. So there's two of everything.
You're very lucky. Did they get to you right away?
They did. I was so extremely lucky that I was in Park City, and that was, I think they found out that was one of 2 days the helicopter could have flown me to the University of Utah, which is one of the best hospitals in the country. And if that helicopter couldn't have flown that day due to weather, I would have died if they...
But they still had to move you to Denver after that, huh?
Yeah, and then that's where, you know, I've been so lucky because I've had all the best help, you know, the best, you know, neuroacute critical care, and then the best rehab. And then from there, I got to come and move in with my parents and have, you know, the best help from my parents. And it's just been kind of this crazy process. And it's been 4 years now, and I'm still healing, and my brain is still getting better.
Next, Kevin has taken his story to the big screen. We'll learn all about it right after the break.
This is not Sean White, but Kevin Pearce might be just as good.
We share the same talent. It was such an exciting time for us.
Road to Vancouver right now. This is the road.
On December 30th on HBO.
How you doing?
Do you know your nickname, Kev? You don't?
Because Peter.
How are you?
Hey everyone, thanks for all your support. I'm doing better.
I still want a snowboard.
You actually could die.
An Academy Award nominated director, right? A woman, right?
Yeah.
What's her name?
Yeah, Lucy Walker made the film.
And tell me, the film encompasses more than just snowboarding, right? It's about you and your brother?
Yeah, you know, it's about, the film is so much more than snowboarding, and you know, it's kind of a great, great explanation of, you know, what is possible when you're knocked down and you're at the bottom. I mean, you saw that clip of how bad I was, and then, you know, my family was there for me, and, you know, my friends have been there for me, and just like what will happen when you have the right support team and the right help to come back, and you can really recover from anything.
Sean White was a competitor of yours, right?
Yeah, me and Sean, we battled it out there, and we were
battling. He's been here.
He has been in with you.
Yeah.
And nice.
You entertain a relationship with him?
Yeah, me and Sean are still friends. And, you know, he is so good at what he does.
This movie has spawned the Love Your Brain campaign. What is that? I see you have the love shirt on.
Yeah, so kind of this is where my kind of life has moved to. And, you know, and I think that love is a great explanation of what this is. And, you know, it's been so hard for me to love my brain and to love myself. But the idea of this and the whole idea behind it is to inspire kids and to educate people of the importance of loving the human brain. And, you know, no matter what happens to it or what's going on with you, that you need to, you know, care for your brain and take care of it and, you know, just ultimately love it.
What's the Kevin Pearce Fund?
So the Kevin Pearce Fund is, you know, what we've started now, and we're selling these T-shirts. And then my dad, Simon Pearce, makes hand-blown glass, and we're selling a piece of glass that he makes. And all of the funds and profits are going to help kids. And it's just, I've learned through this and going, you know, from this movie being made and everything that I've gone through, how much suffering is really going on in this world now. And, you know, how many people are really having a tough time with whatever it is, you know, Down syndrome, brain injuries, whatever it is. There's so many different things. And I, you know, feel like that I have a great ability to help people and, you know, to help make a change.
Your father does great glasswork. You see, you gave me one of those. It's really terrific. And is he in California now or still in Vermont?
No, they're in Vermont. I'm actually going home to be with the family tomorrow in Vermont for Thanksgiving.
Why did you move to California?
It's sunny and it's warm. And I called them yesterday and they were all freezing and it's snowing in Vermont right now. And I was like out on the beach just lying in my ice.
But don't you love the snow?
I do. And that's why I'm so excited to go home tomorrow to get to be with them and play in the snow, because the snow is, you know, that's, you know, my favorite place to be.
Do you miss competitive snowboarding?
You know, I do. Competitive snowboarding is what I loved most, and that's, you know, that was my true passion and what I had the most fun doing. And to lose that is, it's really hard not to have that anymore.
You're sorry you're not going to Sochi?
You know, I am going to Sochi.
Well, you're going.
I'm going too. You are.
Yeah, I gotta moderate a pound speaking there, and then we'll do some tapes there too.
Nice. I'm gonna carry the torch for the opening ceremonies.
For the American team?
Yeah, so I'm going, but I'm
how
not
good are we going to, how well are we going to do?
In snowboarding, we're going to do really well. You know, I don't know about the other sports, but, you know, the snowboarding is, you know, the American snowboarders are at the top of the snowboarding.
Have you been to Sochi?
I never have.
It's a resort city, right, I think?
Yeah, I don't know what's going on over there, but it's going to be cool.
I don't know.
You've been to Russia?
I've been to Moscow.
Okay.
And I've been to Kiev. I've been to... You know, but I've never been to Sochi. You carrying the torch for the American team. Is it hard for you to watch other snowboarders?
You know, it's not. It's really fun for me to get to watch this sport progress and move forward. And, you know, it's still moving forward, and new stuff that has never been done before is happening. And it's so fun to watch that.
What are your plans the rest of your life? What do you want to do?
Yeah, you know, it's crazy, Larry, just because my life has taken such a change. It was like I was on this set path, and I was a snowboarder, and I was competing, and I was successful, and that was my life. I never went to college. I never did anything except snowboard. And then I was in Park City, fell, had this accident, and now I have to figure out what's next. And, you know, this love movement has been, you know, helping and giving back and, you know, giving support to people that are in such serious need of it has really been something that has really felt amazing to me.
Do you have a website?
Yeah, it's kevinpearce.com and loveyourbrain.com. And
kevinpearce.com, loveyourbrain.com.
And it's been awesome, because to be able to sell this and help people and, you know, give back is just such a cool feeling.
You're an amazing guy. Thanks, Kevin.
Thanks for having me on, man.
Thank you to my guest, Kevin Pearce, for sharing his moving story. And make sure you check out Kevin's documentary, The Crash Reel, and go to kevinpearce.com to learn more about the Kevin Pearce Fund. Up next, we meet another inspiring athlete, Kevin Laue. Stay with us. Born without a left arm below the elbow, Kevin Laue overcame the odds, earned a full basketball scholarship to Division I Manhattan College. His inspiring story is now coming to the big screen in documentary form. The 6'10 Kevin joins us now to chat about his film, Long Shot, The Kevin Laue Story. Wow. What do they call that when you were born without a lower left arm?
I call it a nub. It's a nickname. But basically what happened, my umbilical cord got wrapped around my neck several times and cut off the circulation of the arm, and actually came out not breathing. So they revived me, and ironically it was on Friday the 13th as well. A little fun fact. But I was lucky You know, the doctor said the umbilical cord could have taken off my neck. So I always joke around about how it was a good price to pay.
Did you ever think about, can they build an attachment to it and give you an arm?
That's a good question. Prosthetic Limb, a great company out of the Bay Area in San Francisco, made an arm for me, about a $60,000 carbon fiber forearm electronic arm. I was like the Terminator, like RoboCop with it. It was amazing.
But
there's always the but. I got it around the time I got a scholarship at Manhattan College, and I can say this now. But my coach and my athletic director bring me in their office and very awkwardly, you know, ask me, like, where'd you get the arm? And I told them, and they're like, Kevin, that's, you know, kind of like a NCAA scholarship. It's like getting a sports car. You know, you could lose your scholarship over it.
You're not allowed to play with that arm?
No, I probably wouldn't be able to play with it. But even receiving of it is in the morally gray area.
I see.
So with the NCAA.
Well, you can do it now, though, right?
I can, yeah.
Will you?
Yeah. It's an interesting tool.
Tell me about growing up.
It was tough. I had a tough childhood. My parents divorced when I was five. And, you know, I was, you know, a little awkward kid. You know, one arm, I'm a giant. I'm like 6'11 now. And the red hair didn't help any. And my dad got cancer when I was about 7 and ended up passing away when I was 10. So I had a very difficult time at a young age. I was 5'10 when I was 10 years old, too.
When did you, so you took up basketball?
I did, yeah. I got cut from the 7th grade team originally, and, you know, a couple coaches here and there put me in the right place to help me progress, and I fell in love with the sport.
And then did you play high school?
I did, yeah, sir.
And then go to Manhattan?
Yeah.
Was you go to junior college or right to Manhattan?
What happened was I progressed and progressed in high school, and I was in the Super Bowl edition of Sports Illustrated my senior year. And I was in my English class, and I got a call from an area code outside what I'm used to with no number behind it. And I picked up in class, and they're like, this is so-and-so from the White House. And I hung up on them. I thought it was a prank. They called me back, and sure enough, it was. And at the time, George W. Bush was interested in meeting me. I got to go to San Francisco Airport, met him coming off Air Force One on the tarmac. Went back that same night to a high school game, and I was a little late, couldn't warm up. I broke my leg, and I lost all my scholarship offers in the same day.
Ooh.
Yeah. And I went to military school in Virginia, Fort Union Military Academy after that to redeem scholarships, and eventually got recruited to Manhattan College.
And how did you play there?
At Fork Union or Manhattan?
How did you play in Manhattan?
It was interesting. Obviously, New York basketball is a whole different type of style. But it was an experience. D1 level is very, very difficult and challenging. But, you know, we had a great crew, and, you know, I love the guys. And by my junior year, we did really, really well.
You start?
I started a couple games. I was on and off. My roommate, Ramel Brown, He's NBA potential. He's one of those guys.
Still there.
He is, yeah. He's a year younger than I was. So, you know, you're battling with one of your best buddies for playing time. It wasn't an easy thing to do, but, man, that guy's a great man.
What'd you major in?
Business management. Ended up graduating in 3 years, too.
So tell me how you played.
Well, like I said, I call this the nub, and it's basically all bone. And, you know, I'm a dirty player on the court. I jab it into people. Coaches say give him a little nubby.
You have to catch with one hand, play with one hand,
yeah,
right?
Exactly. I play with one hand. My idol, Bill Walton, and Kareem Abdul-Jabbar were kind of guys that I based my game upon. I actually had the pleasure of meeting Kareem in New York not too long ago, and I got to thank him for, you know, being an inspiration to me.
Great guy. Sure. But was it, you obviously you couldn't throw two-handed pass. You couldn't.
Yeah.
Hard to catch the ball?
Not for me, really. I mean, I always argued, prospectively, I don't know what it's like to have two arms. So I do the best with, you know, what I have. And, you know, I don't find it very difficult at all. But other people in the audience, you know, college coaches, recruits, whoever, you know, are just blown away and amazed that I can do, you know, what they can't, basically. You know, but I think it's just a blessing in disguise.
Had a tough time rebounding?
Not at all. I was best at blocking shots and rebounding. I could tip the ball up pretty well and bring it down when I needed to, and I could palm the ball very easily. You know, having one hand, I had to learn to have basically perfect footwork, you know, which helped get you in position to rebound.
Were you envious of your friends?
For having two hands?
Yeah.
You know, there was times, you know, up and down, I'm human like anybody else. Roy Williams once told me that he shook my hand and he said, son, if you had two arms, you'd be a first draft pick. And that was in ways, you know, the best and worst thing I've ever heard.
Yeah.
Because it was like, wow, this guy's, you know, legendary. It was so nice of him, you know, to think that much about my game. But at the same time, I can't do anything about having one hand.
Do they know if you would have been left-handed or right-handed?
I'm supposed to be left-handed.
How would they know that?
The doctors kind of figured it out at first, the umbilical cord being around my left arm, and I kick with my left foot.
Oh, really? Yeah. So you would have been left, wow.
Yeah, and it actually kind of helped with coordination, because although I'm naturally better with my left side, obviously had to learn to do everything with the right. So
who was the angel pitcher?
Jim Abbott.
Jim Abbott, I knew Jim. I interviewed him, I forgot his name. He pitched a no-hitter.
He did for the Yankees. Childhood hero. And honestly,
I love
it.
Great guy.
They say don't meet your childhood role model. For me, it was the best thing ever. I sat down with him. He's the most genuine character. He came out with a book last year, and he signed me a copy to one of my heroes, Kevin Laue. And, you know, he gave me the time of day. I've met him several times. He's a wonderful man.
Yeah, we're going to talk about the documentary and everything. We'll learn more about Kevin's remarkable story on and off the court. Stay tuned. We're back with Kevin Laue. Tell me about the documentary.
The documentary is called The Long Shot, and we filmed it for about 4.5 years. The director, Frank Martin, you know, picked it up and started filming me around sophomore, junior year of high school. And neither one of us knew at the time, you know, it was going to progress as it did, and my story would, you know, become one to inspire, you know, millions. You know, we didn't know at the end of the day that I was going to get a D1 scholarship. I mean, it's everybody's goal as a athlete in high school to play in the collegiate level. But, you know, he took the chance on filming the movie and, you know, caught me breaking my leg, meeting Bush, this and that. And
so everything's in the film.
Everything is in the film, including, you know, some pieces with my dad. I had a hard, you know, relationship with him as well. So I don't want to give too much away, but it's a little bit of a tearjerker.
And this was for big screen films in theaters?
Or? It is, yeah, select theaters. We just aired it out in my hometown as the first screening. And unbelievable experience, because, you know, a lot of the people were actually in the film, you know, and hadn't seen it, and got to know the whole story.
And wow, I'm anxious to see it.
Thank you so much.
All right, Zach Hodgkins now of Milton, Georgia, just has a walk-on deal with the Florida Gators. He has one arm. You know him or seen him play?
I texted him this morning.
Yeah?
He just said something to me that was probably one of the best things I ever heard. He said, Kevin, you've been my role model, and you're the reason I got into basketball. And, you know, for me being the first D1 player, you know, I had to deal with all these different obstacles, you know, with recruits and this and that. But at the end of the day, I can sleep well at night knowing that I opened the door for people with similar obstacles.
He's a walk-on.
Yes, but, man, that kid is a stud. Let me tell you, I've seen clips on him. We're different positions, and that
tall is he?
He's going to earn a scholarship at Florida.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. He's a guard. I'm not sure his exact height.
He's a guard with one arm?
Unbelievable. Unbelievable, that kid.
And that's a good program.
Yeah.
The Gators don't fool around.
Yeah. They're a really good school. I'm going to do my best to mentor him and help him any way I can.
Billy's the coach.
Yeah.
That's great. Were you unfairly treated on the court? How were you treated by opponents?
It depends on the opponents. Having one arm, a person would come out and be like, I have the day off. I get to play the cripple kid. You know, it's, you know, not to be sexist. It's almost like playing a girl. You know, people come out underestimating me from the get-go, which I use to my advantage. You know, I come out and play hard from the beginning, and, you know, I surprise them. You know, there was quite a few players that really just didn't like playing against me, and I give people welts with this thing. I don't blame them by any means.
You were a rough player then.
I had to be. You know, you use what you had, and this guy is very strong, very sharp, lethal weapon.
Did any other schools look at you?
Yeah, I had quite a few schools look at me. Unfortunately, my academics, unlike most students, worked against me. D1 schools really didn't want to give me the chance. You know, coaches getting fired, this and that. I had pretty, you know, strong academic grades in high school.
That worked against you?
Everyone wanted to give me an academic scholarship, partial scholarship, this and that.
You graduated in 3 years. What are you going to do with your life?
I'm doing motivational speaking now, flying over the world. I spoke at the UN General Assembly room last year, and going up to Philippines and Taiwan pretty soon. you know, just sharing my story and motivating others. It's an unbelievable experience.
What do you tell them?
Depending on the audience, but just really my testimony. I mean, I've been through so much, and, you know, I never asked to be. But, you know, if you persevere in life and you try hard enough and overcome what you need to, really nothing is out of reach.
What was military school like?
It was really fun. And,
why would military school take someone without an arm?
That's a good question. I went there for the basketball program. Coach Fletcher Arrett there is absolute legend for basketball.
What school was it?
Fork Union Military Academy, based in Virginia. And the motto there, it's the worst place to be at, the best place to be from. And that's really the truth.
Really?
Yeah. It's tough.
How was life in New York City for you?
Unbelievable. I mean, when you run into people like Kareem Abdul-Jabbar or Cal Ripken Jr., these people, it's the biggest platform on the world. And I had quite a bit of media attention out there. And I'll never forget the day a firefighter was on a fire truck going through Times Square with the lights on. And the guy in the back of the truck, one of the firemen, pointed at me in Times Square. He's like, Kevin Laue. And, you know, that's when I just knew, you know, New York was just...
All right, Kevin, now since you don't have NCAAs to worry about, would you take on an arm?
You know, I have it. To be honest, for me, it's a little unusual. I don't know prospectively if you can imagine holding a broomstick at the end of your arm and trying to be coordinated with it. I don't know if that's a good analogy or not, but
they made
there's
so
no
many
feeling.
Advances, haven't they?
They did, yeah. And it's not for everybody, but at the same time, they're amazing. I mean, amazing, especially for wounded warriors and this and that. My issue is that I've never had two arms, so I don't feel like I'm missing anything. So I use my arm here almost like a hand or an extra palm.
So putting something. Say if you've had two arms, you still feel like you have an arm. When people lose a leg, they still feel like they have a leg.
Yeah.
You have no feeling, right?
Yeah, I can't relate. No feeling at all.
Did kids make fun of you or understand?
It was tough, you know, growing up. I was bullied a little bit. I mean, everybody's teased to an extent. I was just a bigger target for it, unfortunately. But, you know, my mom, very blessed to have her in my life. You know, she gave me a certain mentality just to not listen to it. And I carried that on throughout basketball and athletics as well. I didn't let it get affecting. One quick story, a high school game. I was on the free throw line and the whole other team's crowd basically put all their arms in their sleeve and they were raving around their nubs and yelling at me. I actually thought it was funny. I was laughing and, of course, made that free throw. But they had a school assembly, and the principal was in the newspaper, and it was a horrible ordeal. But
you're a great story, Kevin. I can't wait to see the movie.
Thank you so much for everything. It's really a pleasure.
Kevin Laue. The movie is Long Shot, the Kevin Laue story. Look for this documentary. It'll be in select theaters throughout Los Angeles and New York, and then hopefully wide everywhere. Something I can't wait to see. And you can find me on Twitter @KingsThings. We'll see you next time.